Dillon.
Thank you. How is everybody doing? Wonderful. Well, have we got an exciting show for you today? I can't wait for the brilliance of this young lady to rub off on me. This is one of the two female, and how many understand that black girls rock? One of the two high schoolers who got accepted into all 8 Ivy League schools across the country. So we're excited that she's gonna be joining us, and that's Augusta Umanzuna. I can't wait for her. I'm ready. Of course, we've got some great gospel artists that will be joining us. And of course, in a few minutes, Debbie Wallace is going to be joining me. And we're going to obviously get the scoop on what's going on with these gospel artists. We've got Kadeem Nichols that's going to join us. We've got some great music in the house. Of course, Life in a Day Off with Deidre Braz. We're going to highlight Moses Vernon. And Moses Vernon, again, she just kind of got up close and personal with him. So you're really going to get into that. She kind of went into his bedroom, went into his kitchen. You know, it's really going to be something when we get to that with Deidre Braz. And of course, as we know, there's so much that's happening. It's Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the house. And as we celebrate Father's Day, of course, we're going to talk about fathers. We're going to talk about the late, great, the greatest Muhammad Ali. So it's going to be an exciting show. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with the Dennis Dillon Show.
You've probably heard a lot about reverse mortgages from celebrities and gotten calls from companies all around the country.
I'm Steve from Perry Funding, and we are your neighbors.
We can sit with you and explain all the benefits of a reverse mortgage.
If you're a homeowner 62 years or older, then you can use a government-insured reverse mortgage as a safe, effective financial tool that allows you to stay in your home and to turn your equity into tax-free cash without any monthly mortgage payments.
Call us at 516-900-1500.
Perry Funding can help you live a better life.
Welcome back. And we've got an exciting, just a dynamic, awesome woman with us, and that is Debbie Wallace.
Hi, good to see you. How again. You doing, Russ?
I'm good. God is good.
Yes, He is, and I am blessed, and I'm excited about the show this week.
Well, I tell you, I'm just looking at the lineup, Kadeem Nichols, and I want to hear more about, you know, who
Kadeem,
he is and all
Kadeem
of that stuff.
Kadeem is a young man that loves God. He has a passion for young people. He is a songwriter, he's a producer, he is an artist, and he's only 25 years old.
Wow.
And I love his spirit, so we're gonna hear from him.
It sounds good, and it's interesting because as we see the energy of our young artists, they stand so much on the shoulder of the fathers. And I think this being Father's Day season, just to reflect on some of the great fathers of gospel music. It's amazing. Yes, so who would be your pick in terms of the father of gospel music?
Well, we should ask, do you guys know who the father of gospel music is? Anyone knows?
The father of gospel music.
Kirk Franklin.
Not Kirk Franklin.
He's like a great, 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 great grandson. Yeah. Who would we say the father is? Anybody? James Cleveland, Marvin Sapp.
No, I think
Marvin.
No.
That's today, right? Yeah. I would venture to say, because James Cleveland certainly have done some stuff, but I would even go back to Thomas Dorsey,
who was first jazz and then gospel,
you know, songs like "Precious Memories," how they linger.
And you know
I mean,
that
almost
song?
All of our parents know that song.
Well, that was my mom's favorite song.
Wow!
Yes, it was my mom's.
And that's a song that has crossed over, by the way. Well, listen, folks, we've got this dynamic young man that you talked about that is coming up. I'm ready
for
us to hear him.
Yes.
Let's put our hands together for Kadeem Nichols.
Clap your hands like this. Now the song is real simple, so I'm just gonna say it real quick. I'm gonna say the hook and then y'all repeat after me, okay? Right here. So I'll say, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart. And then y'all will say, give me your, give me your. That sound good. Right here. When I look into the mirror, I wanna see everything you say that I'm supposed to be. A mere reflection of your actions, an imitation of your ways. And I don't wanna wait, so please do this today, oh Lord. Because I know that I can never change without you. So here I am, cause I don't wanna be the same. I wanna be different, I wanna be new. See, I just wanna be like you, so give me your heart. Yeah, oh yeah, make me who you want me to be. Take this old heart out of me and give me your heart. So this is the part where I need your help. I'ma sing the hook first. Yeah. So I'll say, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart. And then y'all will say, yes, all good. Because this heart tends to slip up, plus I'm prone to make mistakes. I need you to fix me over, put this heart in the right place. Because I can't afford to live this life and die with this disease. So cut me open, cause I'll gladly go through the surgery. And give me love for hate. Give me faith for my disbelief and give me joy for pain. Lord, just take all of me and let my heart beat only to your will. Let's face it, I wouldn't have it any other way. So take my heart today because, Lord, I know that I can never change without you. So here I am, cause I don't wanna be the same. I wanna be different, I wanna be new. See, I just wanna be like you. So give me your heart. Come on, y'all can clap. Yeah, yeah. Make me who you want me to be. Take this old heart out of me and give me your heart, yeah. Right here. Help me sing, so I say, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart, yeah. Y'all sound good. Yeah, yeah, give me your, give me your, give me your heart, yeah. Cause this heart I have is broken, it's tainted, it's shattered. Need a replacement, need an exchange from you. This heart is what I'm after, that's all that really matters. Until I get it, I won't faint, cause I wanna be different, I wanna be new. See, I just wanna be like you, so give me your heart. That's all I want to do. say, yeah, make me who you want me to be. And take this old heart out of me and give me your heart. Yeah, 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 yeah. So I say, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart. Help me say, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, give me your, give me your, give me your. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I wanna be different, I wanna be new. See, I just wanna look like you, so give me your heart. Yeah. No, make me who you want me to be. Take this old heart out of me and give me your heart. That's my prayer today, yeah. So I say, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart. Lord, give me your, give me your, give me your, give me your heart. God bless. Yeah.
Kadeem, thank you, man. That was, wow, that was great.
Yeah,
I just
that
love
was
the
amazing.
Words.
Yes, I love that
heart.
Song. Yes.
Is that God you're talking to, or is it God talking to you?
Nah, that's me talking to God. Mm. You know, it's a prayer, it's a desire. Like, I want more of God, and I want more of His heart. Wow. That's what's going to change, you
beautiful.
Know, the world.
Did you write this song, Kadeem?
Yes, I did.
This is a beautiful song. I wanted to ask you, who is your greatest influence as far as music is concerned?
One of my greatest influences is Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder. Yeah. And what about gospel music?
Gospel music? Fred Hammond. Like,
Fred
yeah,
Hammond.
It's one of my
awesome.
Favorite.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
yes.
I mean, tell you, those are two great yeah. men, no doubt. I'm not sure if Fred Hammond is a father, but I know Stevie Wonder is.
Yeah, definitely.
And,
Fred
and
Hammond
we certainly
is.
Want
is
to salute him
yes,
and
yes.
all the fathers on
yes.
this Father's Day.
Yes, we yeah. do. Mm-hmm. We want to do that. I wanted to, I know that you have a passion for young people. What do you want them to get out of your music, listening to your music?
I just want for youth, young adults, and even, you know, adults to really strive to be more like Christ and to, you know, enjoy that life, because it's freedom. It's true freedom in Christ. So.
It's amazing because gospel music always takes us back to God.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that your message, the central theme, is always for folks to connect even more deeply with
yes.
God is amazing.
Yes. And yes.
Especially where do you see your ministry
people.
Going?
Yes.
Man, whatever God wants it to go, I'm ready. So, mm. I'm
well,
just
you know what? We're so happy that you're here, and we want to wish you all the success.
Thank you.
Well,
thank
God bless you. Thank you, Kadeem Nichols, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
You probably heard a lot about reverse mortgages from celebrities and gotten calls from companies all around the country.
I'm Steve from Perry Funding, and we are your neighbors.
We can sit with you and explain all the benefits of a reverse mortgage.
If you're a homeowner 62 years or older, then you can use a government-insured reverse mortgage as a safe, effective financial tool that allows you to stay in your home and to turn your equity into tax-free cash without any monthly mortgage payments.
Call us at 516-900-1500.
Perry Funding can help you live a better life.
Welcome back, welcome back. I want to welcome everyone back to the Dennis Dillon Show, and I have this dynamic young lady that I'm talking to. Her name is Augusta Umanzuna, and she is on her way to Harvard. God bless you. How are you? I tell you, I have been reading about you like for 3-4 months, and of all the people in the world I want to meet, I wanted to meet Augusta.
Wow,
so I'm just excited meeting you.
Thank you.
You tell me how you managed to be here in New York,
yes.
and be that one high school student who get accepted into 8 Ivy League schools. That's just amazing
yes.
to me.
Honestly, I can't say that there's a secret or anything. People have asked me what's in the water at Elmont, and I tell them nothing.
That's interesting, because last year another young man from Elmont High School also got into all eight Ivy League. So,
But honestly, when looking at this and looking at all of my recent accomplishments, I owe it all to the strong Elmont community. Firstly, of course, God, of course, my parents, but the strong Elmont community, where teachers really work to see that students maximize their potential and really expect so much of you despite, you know, our trying circumstances at times. So really just growing up in that environment where not only your teachers but your peers really support you academically has really contributed to my development, and I'm really thankful for that.
And I'm happy you share that, because this African proverb, it takes a village to raise a child.
Definitely.
I hear that the community had such an important role in your development, your parents, God.
Exactly.
That's really, really amazing. Yes. So what's your favorite subject?
My favorite subject is science, but I'm interested in so many different things.
Mm-hmm.
So science and math.
Okay.
Definitely.
All right. Well, I tell you, I'm not big at science. So from this point on, if I need to know anything, I'm going to call Augusta, because, I mean, you're just amazing.
Thank you so much.
Well, let's talk about your journey. Were you born here in the United States? Your parents are from where? And just how you managed to just rise above all the challenges that other young people are dealing with.
So both of my parents are Nigerian immigrants. They were born in Nigeria, and my father married my mother, and then they came over in the mid-1990s, and they actually started out in Indiana because my father had studied physical therapy, and that's where that job and that major landed him in Indiana. So I was born there, along with my older brother, who now attends Cornell University.
Wow.
And then when I was two, I moved to New York, so it's pretty much like I spent my whole life in New York. And honestly, just hearing the stories of my parents, particularly my father, who started off working as a houseboy in Nigeria in exchange for an education, and just learning how he was able to make so much out of so little. He grew up during the civil war in Nigeria, and just seeing all of that really motivated me to do well and motivated me to just bring smiles to my parents' faces. And honestly, I found that the easiest way to do that was through academics, because whenever I would get an award, they would be so happy.
Wow, that's amazing.
So that has really motivated me to just do well, but I didn't know that I would end up with getting accepted into all eight Ivy League schools.
Tell me about the application process. You literally applied to all of them?
Yes, all of them.
Well, how many schools did you apply to in total?
I applied to 12 schools in total, and I got accepted into all of them.
So all 12?
Yes. So I got into the eight Ivy League schools, along with MIT, Johns Hopkins, New York University, and Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. And honestly, all the applications were really tedious and long. But I just, you know, prayed every day and had faith in God and asked Him to guide me. Because honestly, and not just the application process, throughout high school, we're faced with so many stressful situations. So just having faith in God and knowing that all of your hard work will not be futile, that it won't be in vain, really kept me going. Mm-hmm. And as an avid Catholic and avid Christian, honestly, that's something I owe to my parents once again. And it's really kept me going throughout these hard
and
trying times.
So tell me, why did you choose Harvard?
Honestly, it was a very hard decision. I committed the last second that I could on May 1st. But when looking at and visiting all the schools, I saw that they had the same things academically, and they had parallel clubs. So it came down to the community of each campus. And for me, at Harvard, I was really drawn to the strong Nigerian community there and the strong Black community there. And my parents, as I mentioned, are Nigerian. They really taught me to value the tenets of the culture, and just knowing that I could feel at home and not change who I am and also thrive as a Black woman really motivated me to choose Harvard over the others. It was a hard choice, but you know, God really spoke to me.
So what do you call an object that has 12 sides?
12 sides. Is that a decahedron?
You're so bright, you know everything. I mean, she knows everything. Y'all put your hands together for her. I mean, I don't know if there's anything I can ask you that you don't know. I mean, how many books are in the Bible?
How many books are in the Bible? How many books are in the Bible? I forgot that number.
I know I would get you on the question.
Oh,
66 books.
66, yes.
66 books are in the Bible. Well, you're just an amazing young woman, and we certainly wish you all the best as you kind of step out and head to Harvard. Talk to young people that are listening and to parents about what they need to do to excel?
Honestly, as I mentioned earlier, there's not necessarily a secret to my success, but honestly, as parents, just supporting your children in all that they want to do and allowing them to explore their options, because throughout high school, I've involved myself in so many different things. By doing that, that's how I found out what I was passionate about. And honestly, I don't know what I want to major in college yet, but that's okay. But I do know that I want to affect change in my community, and just knowing to keep an open mind in terms of academics and do not limit yourself. Try different things. And by doing that, you might find something that you're passionate about, and you might find something that you can transform into a lifetime career.
So let's talk future. Where do you see this taking you? What plans do you have in terms of a profession?
So I was initially thinking medical school, and I probably will still go to medical school, but I've done science research with cement and concrete for 3 years, which has ultimately introduced me to the importance of sustainable infrastructure development. Mm. So that has kind of opened my eyes to the importance of environmental science and sustainable development. So I hope to also pursue that. And I've been involved with business, so I feel like in any career, I would like use business skills. So honestly, at Harvard, I just want to explore so many different things and just see where God guides me and see where it takes
you
me.
You sound like you're going to Harvard to teach the professors. You know, you are just so brilliant and such a dynamic woman. And we're just grateful to God for all that you're doing. Anything you need, feel free. We're here at the Brooklyn Christian Center and at the New York Christian Times to support you
and to
encourage you. We want her to rise and succeed in all that she does. Ladies and gentlemen, let's put our hands together for Augusta.
You probably heard a lot about reverse mortgages from celebrities and gotten calls from companies all around the country.
I'm Steve from Perry Funding, and we are your neighbors.
We can sit with you and explain all the benefits of a reverse mortgage.
If you're a homeowner 62 years or older, then you can use a government-insured reverse mortgage as a safe, effective financial tool that allows you to stay in your home and to turn your equity into tax-free cash without any monthly mortgage payments.
Call us at 516-900-1500.
Perry Funding can help you live a better life.
Welcome back. Welcome back to the Dennis Dillon Show. And Deidre, I don't know how you do this, but you find all of these dynamic people. You're truly an investigative reporter. Tell me about this one.
Okay, so we got to see the Life in a Day of Real Talk, but now we get to see the reason why I created lifeinadayof.com, which is where I feature and film the life in a day of celebrities, sports figures, and high-profile guests while they're working, while they're on their grind. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of it is to motivate and inspire people by showing them that hard work, effort, and energy that it really takes to make dreams happen.
Yeah.
So, go ahead.
I was going to say, this guy, Moses, Vernon. Mm-hmm. I've never heard of him before, but I'm looking at the piece and I'm saying, wow, this guy has done some amazing things.
Well, you've been under a rock. But he is the creator of the hit YouTube series Money and Violence.
Wow.
This is a man with no directing experience, and him and his cast, no acting experience whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And after 3 episodes, he had the entire Brooklyn talking.
Wow.
Okay. So
he's from Brooklyn.
Yes, he sure is. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why I was so delighted to feature him, because I'm, a fellow Brooklynite. Uh-huh. But after doing their first season independently, they were picked up by Jay-Z to feature their second season on Tidal and their third season with Lionsgate. So they're pretty much ready
Some really good stuff. So what I want to do is to probably get to it, let everybody take a look at this piece, and we could come back, Deidre, and talk about it on the other side.
It's
awesome. You got to keep up the good work.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
right now, and I ask you these questions, don't even think about them, just answer. Okay. Whatever the first thing that comes to your mind.
Okay.
What is your greatest strength?
Communication.
What did life teach you yesterday?
Be on time.
If your life was a movie, what would be the title?
A Bright Future Out of a Dark Past.
Time or money?
Time.
If you had to teach something, what would you teach?
Love.
When was the last time you tried something new, and what was it?
Try something new every day. I'm on a set, learning all this new stuff.
What activities make you lose track of time?
Candy Crush.
Watching the life and the day of me.
So where did you see this going from when you first started the show compared to where you are now?
When I first started the show, I never even thought this far. You know, you have to understand that this show was my way to kind of give the younger generation a little guidance. You know, that's why there were so many messages buried in every single episode. But at this point now, it's still the same thing, you know. It's a show that I really wanna voice my thoughts and use it as a platform to share my voice as far as socially conscious issues and other things that are going on, not only in the world, but in our urban communities. But the great thing is now, what I see for the show is reaching an audience much larger than what I could have ever anticipated.
Talk a lot about this generation missing a lot of key things. What are some things you hope to restore in this up-and-coming generation through your show?
Through the show, I just hope to... It seems that maybe 15 to 20 years ago, we've adopted this money over everything ideology. You know, I would die for the money, I would die for the bread. You know, money comes before everything, but what people don't realize is once you adopt that kind of ideology, that also means money before principles, that means money before loyalty, morals, all of these things that are very important to us as human beings and our moral fiber. When you value what isn't important, then you devalue what is. With us, you know, like, with my crew, our mantra is maybe be broke together before we're ever rich apart, because we understand that it's not about the money, you know. Money may be the reward, but it should never be the motivation.
Production to be stepped up, our acting skills stepped up. Yeah, what else, Boogie?
I mean, everything, man. The whole development between the actors, the cast, the crew, production-wise, like you said, the whole shebang.
Brooklyn, we back!
Working with Mr. Mo, aka Rafe, aka the Mastermind, aka the head of the Voltron. It's been a lot. You would think it would be a lot much easier, being the fact that we have a production team, but the work ethic still remains the same. Still putting in that work as if we just started filming from day one.
You mentioned in an interview, one of the most amazing things is being able to sit back and watch the world get to know you. What responsibility do you now feel you have to everyone and those looking up to you after what you achieved this far?
I mean, I believe that, you know, it's funny because I'm a very private person, but I've come to learn that although I'm a very private person, I cannot use that as an excuse to do what it is that anything that I may feel, because now I'm somewhat in the public eye. You know, a lot of these young kids, they look up to what we're doing. And it's not enough for me to just prove to them that I can do it, but I need to set a positive example. You know, don't get me wrong, we're all flawed, nobody's perfect, and I'm not trying to be perfect. But at the end of the day, if what I put out there can be the difference between, you know, a child having the influence to go the right path or the wrong, then, you know, I'm gonna do everything in my power. Because I see it this way, just as the person that I am in front of my child is who I need to be in front of everybody else's children. You know, so I take that responsibility very seriously.
What are some eye-openers or jewels you've learned through your life experiences that helped you become who you are today?
Jewels and eye-openers. I think one of the biggest jewels that I've learned is that no matter how good you are to people, it doesn't mean they'll be good back. It doesn't mean that they'll be good to you. And that's just out of, you know, my past with those who I was close to, who I thought were close to me. And a lot of people have motives and agendas, and a lot of people, the only reason that they're around you is because you're beneficial at the moment. You know, and sometimes it's a hard pill to swallow, and you have to go through things before these people expose their motives or expose who they are. So I've learned to be a very, very good judge of character and to read in between the lines and to see beyond people's words and really be able to read their actions, because no one ever really gives you the full picture of who they are. You actually see the truth in little moments where they give you glimpses, and you have to piece those together to really be able to tell, you know, who's the true person that you're dealing with.
Now, I know you posted a pic a while ago of you and Ebro, and you mentioned that situation. So I just wanted to know, how does someone remain as focused while going through the death of their mother and still being able to shoot a scene with Ebro on the same day? Not many people can go through something that deep and, you know.
I'm a very logical person, for one. And for two, a long time ago, I came to learn that the heart and mind exist totally independent of one another, you know, and it's sort of like forever at war. That's why most times what you feel doesn't make sense, you know. And when it came to the situation with my mom, I just made sense of it. You know, at the end of the day, some people lose their parents at the young age of 5, 6, as adolescents. Some people lose their parents as teens. So for me, someone who had my mother till I was well into my late 30s, like, who am I? Who am I to feel like I'm being wronged, you know? So rather than get down about it, I just chose to be grateful and to tell the Lord thank you for the amount of time that he did allow me to spend on this earth with my mother. And with that said, what's happening now is something that was pretty much a lifetime in the making. And my mother, she watched me try everything from music to clothing to the website to the media company. And I knew that at that moment, she would have wanted me to keep going, and the last thing that she would have wanted was for her to be the reason why I didn't. So, and you also have to remember that with this entire situation, I'm the captain of the ship. And it's funny because had it been anyone else in my cast, I would not have let them shoot that scene that day. But as the captain of the ship, it is my responsibility to make all the sacrifices. And it is my responsibility not even to set an example, but just to be the one that makes the sacrifices. I mean, the things that are impossible just to make everything happen. So with that said, I could not see me faltering. You know,
everything that you go through in life, you seem like you learn from it, and don't let anything go by without either learning from it or noticing it. So how does one become that conscious?
I think it's just a constant pursuit to be better, because that's the whole thing with me. You know, there's not a point that I could ever get to in life where I think that I know enough. or I can think that I'm anything close to perfect. No, there's always going to be flaws. There's always going to be things that I can improve on. So because of that, I mean, that keeps me humble and that keeps me grounded no matter what, because I truly believe that I am not perfect and I will never be perfect. All I can do is strive to be better. So this is my day. It's a blessing, though. I look to the sky every night and say, thank you, Lord. So you got to give me reaction. So I have a bridge from the time you say your first line to the time you say your next line. What, we can get Billboard magazine, New York Times?
Billboard, the New Yorker, and
New York Times? Yo, oh, what's up? This is Mr. Everybody.
Nice. Hey. Someone say that one more time.
Yo, say that one more time.
No.
Nah, go ahead, say it one more time.
I'm not
say it, go ahead, say it one more time. Yeah. Say it one more time, you're on camera. It's not always about money, you know. That's how most people are blinded. That's how most people are got. You know, with all the deals that I secured and that I decided to go along with, none of them were front end heavy, meaning that none of them were heavy on advances. Why? Because I was more concerned with residuals. I'm well aware that the more money I get on the front end, the less I'm gonna get on the back end. You know, so you can give me $5 million today, and then that can cause me not to make money forever, you know? So I'd rather take nothing up front.
Right.
And give me 20% perpetually, forever. You know, that's how you build wealth.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, that's what I can leave for my child. That's what I can leave for my children. Because my worst nightmare is to be 90, 95 years old, laying in a hospital bed, surrounded by my kids, you know, on my deathbed, and they're not financially secure, and a show that I created is playing on television and they're not seeing a red cent off of it.
Yeah.
So because of that, I can't be money motivated, you know? Money is the reward, it's never the motivation. Too many people say, money makes the world go round. No, it does not. People's dreams do. It just so happens that we get money in the process of achieving our dreams.
No matter what people tell you, no matter how tough things get, you need to always remember that the only human hands that can stop you are your own.
So, this is an amazing man.
Yes.
How did you find him? Where did you find him?
I do my research. When I'm looking up these headliners, his show is very raw, very gritty about the mm-hmm. Brooklyn streets, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. he drops a gem in every single episode. So once I saw that, he's someone I had to feature. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. another thing is, today is Father's Day, mm-hmm. so I wanted to feature him because he has an amazing relationship with his daughter, Storm. If I'm not mistaken, she may be 12 or 13, mm-hmm. and she also acts on the show,
okay.
and mm-hmm. he made her as a producer on the show, so I had to feature him.
She's a 13-year-old producer.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
This is amazing.
So
this is amazing. So, and it's interesting as we're talking about that, because today's show, we're highlighting just not only the power and strength of fathers and fatherhood, but also the strength of young people.
Exactly.
And all of that. And I'm seeing all of these men around him. Mm-hmm. How does he mentor these young people, particularly given the fact that there's so many black men that are losing their way?
I think he's a man who leads by example.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of them are under him, and it's just a project that him and his friends put together and said, let's just do this. It was just for fun, he said. Mm-hmm. You know, so they got a lot of people that they felt could be a part of the project, and
awesome.
They've just been watching him and learning from him by example.
I can't wait for next week's DJ. Thank you, DJ Brad. That was awesome once again. I can't wait for next week. For the next edition of Life in a Day Off with Deidre Brass.
You've probably heard a lot about reverse mortgages from celebrities and gotten calls from companies all around the country.
I'm Steve from Perry Funding, and we are your neighbors.
We can sit with you and explain all of the benefits of a reverse mortgage.
If you're a homeowner 62 years or older, then you can use a government-insured reverse mortgage as a safe, effective financial tool that allows you to stay in your home and to turn your equity into tax-free cash without any monthly mortgage payments.
Call us at 516-900-1500.
Perry Funding can help you live a better life.
Well, thank you, thank you. We are around the water cooler here on the Dennis Dillon Show. Debbie, Deidre.
This is my favorite section.
Yes.
I like this too, because then I get to sit in the middle of the two beautiful ladies.
Thank you so
much. So it's really, really exciting.
Thank you. But
what a show. There's just so much
great,
that was shared.
Show.
I'm inspired.
And I am too. I'm inspired. I loved the music was great, and I love the young lady, Augusta. I mean, what an inspiration for other young people to, you know.
She's almost scary. You know? I mean, when you talk to somebody with that level of brilliance, you better know who you are and what you're talking about. And I just love how she just articulates, and she's already this professional.
Yeah,
like
she
graduated from grad school a long time
she's
ago.
She's gonna do well.
At Harvard. And it also speaks to the fact that we've got young people with all of this intellectual capacity and strength and power that we're just going to have to validate and support them.
Absolutely. And then Deidre's piece was also great also.
Thank you.
I mean, the person, his influence, and just to see how hard he works. Mm-hmm. And knowing that, you know what, if he can do it, anyone can do it.
Exactly.
Isn't that awesome?
Exactly.
And, you know, I've never heard of this gentleman, Moses, before, but I've learned so much about him.
Yes.
But it also speaks to the fact that there are so many great dynamic people out there. There are so many great fathers. And once again, Happy Father's Day to all the
happy
fathers.
Father's Day
there are so
to
many
everyone.
Great fathers out there that's doing,
happy
that, doing
Father's
awesome
Day.
Stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's some great dads that are doing some wonderful things. And you know what? We have to encourage our fathers.
Mm-hmm.
We have to encourage them because a lot of times they don't get the recognition that they deserve.
Exactly.
You know, you find around Mother's Day, you know, they make a big fuss about Mother's Day.
Mm-hmm.
But Father's Day is always so low-key. You guys agree with me?
Yeah.
Always so low-key. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we really need to encourage and motivate our fathers.
And I want to thank you for bringing Kadeem, because I really like his passion and his music.
Yes.
And Kadeem, you're going places. We're excited about where the Lord is taking you.
Great young man, yes.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the greatest. You know,
the greatest.
Because
who's the greatest?
In that season, just funeralized Muhammad Ali.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our condolences continue to go out to his family.
But what an
inspiration he was.
He was a great man. Great example that he set. And you know what I loved about him?
Mm-hmm.
I loved that he was a poet.
Oh my
gosh. And that he was almost like a rapper. Back in his day, that he would just spit out those rhymes, you know?
Yes.
And just have people. I love that.
Mm-hmm.
What was your favorite quote?
Well, I've got a lot, so let's hear Deidre's
first. Yeah, I'll go first because you might take a little minute. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My favorite quote, I would have to say, would be, "I am the greatest. I said that before I knew I was."
Yeah, wow.
Confidence and believing in yourself is so important. So that is my favorite quote.
And I think when you look at all of his quotes, I mean, you almost want to think it borders along the lines of arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
But if you really want to succeed in life, you got to know who you are.
Right.
And you got to be determined.
He was confident.
So when you talk about float himself, like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
There we go.
Yes. You know what was my favorite quote?
Mm-hmm.
My favorite quote is, "If they can make penicillin out of moldy bread, they can sure make something out of you." Wow. And it just goes to say, you know, you can have, you know, anybody could be used.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Anybody could be used, and I love that. You know what? He's going to be missed by so many people. Mm-hmm. He set an example for young art leagues that are coming up now, and that integrity. And one of the young men that I admire is that, what's that basketball player's name?
Which one?
One on the team right now that's playing.
Many on the team.
The one that sets a great. Mm-hmm. I love his passion, mm-hmm. and I love that he stands what he stands for. Yes.
Okay, there we go.
Oh, excuse me, if you're watching.
You're gonna leave that to the basketball fan to fill in the gap there for.
But you know what? What a great example, though. Mm-hmm. A great example. That's the point I'm trying to make. A great example, and Muhammad Ali will be missed.
He certainly will be, and we're just grateful for just all that he has done, because he has communicated so many strong messages. When he make a statement like, I hospitalize a brick.
Yes.
I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
I told you he was a rapper. He was a poet back in his day. He really was.
So we can't talk about Muhammad Ali without talking about how great of a father he was. Today is Father's Day. To seven daughters, mm-hmm. two sons. Mm-hmm. Layla Ali, which we all know, recently mm-hmm. talked about. She mentioned something I think we all go through. We don't want to see anyone we love go through pain.
Of course.
And she mentions that knowing that he is not suffering anymore gives her comfort.
Right.
And that she mentally prepared for this for years. Mm-hmm. But on a happier note, she talks about the confidence that she was able to receive from him and that he instilled in her.
Right.
And the love and affection that he gave all of his kids.
Right. Mm-hmm. And she followed in his legacy.
Exactly.
I love that. Right. She followed, you know, after him and wanted to be like him, you know, and be one of the greatest.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Yes. So, Reverend Dillon, what is our inspirational word for today?
Well, I tell you, we're continuing in the rise up theme. And I'm going to talk about how we rise up, particularly when we communicate with God.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about us really being able to effectively communicate with God.
Mm. Powerful.
And on that note, we'll be right back with our inspirational word from Reverend Dillon.
You've probably heard a lot about reverse mortgages from celebrities and gotten calls from companies all around the country.
I'm Steve from Perry Funding, and we are your neighbors.
We can sit with you and explain all the benefits of a reverse mortgage.
If you're a homeowner 62 years or older, then you can use a government-insured reverse mortgage as a safe, effective financial tool that allows you to stay in your home and to turn your equity into tax-free cash without any monthly mortgage payments.
Call us at 516-900-1500.
Perry Funding can help you live a better life.
Thank you. I'm so happy that you've chosen to join us on the Dennis Dillon Show. And I'm truly inspired by the very notion of sharing God's love and God's word with you. By the way, all of my teachings are available on PowerPoint and in other applications. So please don't be afraid to connect with us. Again, the address and information is on your screen. It's available to you. And by the way, if you'd like to get a copy of this Rise Up poster, you know, this is a vision that the Lord has given to me. Please connect with us. We'll make that available to you. And of course, the Rise Up book is coming up very soon. You'll certainly have that available as well. By the way, the Brooklyn Christian Center, we are at 1061 Atlantic Avenue between Franklin and Klassen Avenues. We invite you to come visit, worship with us every Sunday at 12 noon. God bless you. And indeed, we look forward to seeing you. Let me just share with you for a few minutes this inspirational word, because I want to make sure that as you leave here today, you know, after listening to all of these inspiring people and seeing what they have done and how they've accomplished, I want to charge and challenge you to rise up and rise above what I call the fish and bread mentality. What do I do to rise above the fish and bread mentality? Let me just share this scripture with you. It is found in John chapter 6 from verse 25. It says, they found him, Jesus that is, on the other side of the lake and asked, Rabbi, when did you get here? Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. You want me because I fed you, not because you understood the miraculous signs that I performed. But don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man came to give. For God the Father has given me the seal of his approval. So I want to talk with us, what is it that I must do to rise above the fish and bread mentality? It cannot be all about what it is that satisfies you in the moment. You got to begin to focus on what it is that you need to do so that indeed you can experience long-term success and long-term victories. That's the charge and challenge I want to leave with you today. Because when you look at Augusta, when you look at Moses and these people that we've just featured and what they've accomplished what they did because at some point they got to delay the gratification. Don't be so caught up in the immediate gratification that you're not focused on the stuff that you need to do that will bring about long-term success. Because success cannot always be in the moment. Success, by the way, is something that you got to work for, you got to long for, you got to desire. The same way Muhammad Ali was determined that he was going to rise and be the greatest, it is the same way you got to be determined that you're going to achieve success. So whenever you go to God, I need us everybody to hear me on this. When you go to God, don't get so caught up in what it is that God can do for you in the moment. Become focused on what it is that you must do with yourself in partnership with God so that you can experience your long-term success. Rise. Rise. So I am committing, I'm committed to rising above the immediate stuff. So here's some thoughts that I want to share with you very, very, very quickly. If you come to God for the wrong reason, you will soon leave when you get what you want or if you don't like what you get. If you come to God for the wrong reason, you're going to soon leave when you get what you want or when you don't want what you get. So what is it that I have to do when I come to God? I got to look at the what I call the Solomon example. Because when Solomon came to God, Solomon could have asked for money. He could have asked for resources. He could have asked for riches. But Solomon simply says, God, give me wisdom that I will understand. Because if I get wisdom, then all the other stuff that I need, I will be able to do for myself. Many of us are too caught up in getting stuff that satisfies us in the moment, as opposed to fighting for the stuff that will give us the capacity that we need, that we're full in the long term. That's why I always say you teach a man to fish, he will have food for a lifetime. But if you give a man a fish, he will only have food for a moment. So my focus is never about satisfying us in the immediate, but what is it that we must do so that in the long term we are satisfied and we are fulfilled. So I say this, if you come to God for comfort, you will leave for pleasure. If you come to God for assurance, you will leave for a relationship. If you come to God for food and drinks, you will leave for some money or employment. If you come to God for security, you will leave for friendship. If you come to God for companionship, you will leave when you get hurt. If you come to God because of fear, you will leave because of pride. If you come to God because you're pulled in by personalities, you will leave because you're also pulled away by personalities. So I got to get deeper in terms of my commitment to God, because without genuine and correct motives, our prayers get grounded in our selfish desires. So I have to elevate my prayers. I have to elevate my thinking and elevate my asks beyond my selfish desires. Are you seeking God for what he can do for you? Or are you seeking God because of who he is? Are you seeking the stuff that you desire to satisfy the moment? Or are you seeking stuff that will make you mature and worthy enough that you can accomplish these things on your own? And I want to say to us that it's about time for men and women who are serious about their rise and making a difference in their lives to look at this from another perspective and rise to the greater level. So hold on to your wish list and give God your will list. Everybody hear that? Hold on to your wish list and give your will list. Because anytime I get to the perspective and I begin to say, God, this is what I will do. This is what I will accomplish. This is how I will perform. This is will. This is what I will do. As opposed to God, do this, do that, do that. God is not our genie in a bottle. God is not our tickle me Elmo. God is not our fairy godmother or godfather on this Father's Day. God is a God who is expecting us to journey to that place where we are asking, but we're asking because there's something deeper, there's something stronger, and there's something mightier. That's why the Word of God says, ask, believe, and you will receive. So when God spoke to Solomon and said, Solomon, ask whatever you will, Solomon did not ask for money, he did not ask for riches, he did not ask for wealth, but Solomon asked for God to release his blessings upon him. So let me give you this affirmation as we get ready to go. Only as I free myself from the fish and bread, hand-to-mouth mentality, am I ready to experience true abundance and the impartation of God's liberating power. God is showing me new things, and I am reviving my ask. This is the affirmation I want you to speak over your life right now. I asked God for strength. He gave me challenges that made me strong. And then asked for wisdom. He gave me problems that I could solve them. I sought God for wealth, and instead, God gave me an active mind, determined will, and the gift of work. And then when I asked God for courage, God gave me danger to overcome. So I'm learning how to revive my ask so that when I ask God, God can and God will release his blessings upon me. This is Pastor Dennis Dillon from the Brooklyn Christian Center thanking you for joining me. And I charge and challenge you, ladies and gentlemen, as we always do at the Brooklyn Christian Center, as we function at our fullest potential in the abundance that God intends, we will rise up and live.